Consul General, Dr. Tota Mirage, members of the diplomatic corps, members of parliament, provincial and municipal representatives, the interfaith leaders, and all others present, I welcome and honor everybody who has assembled here to mark this anniversary. I feel honored to have been asked to speak at this celebration of the 52nd anniversary of the independence of Trinidad and Tobago. In this talk, I shall reflect on two matters of great significance and meaning to me. First, I'm dedicated to understanding the conditions for the success of states and the societies over which they have authority. And since I was born in Trinidad, I'm deeply interested in the well-being of this Twin Island Republic. Although I grew up in Canada and was educated and have my career here, I have a strong connection to the place of my birth and carry an abiding commitment to the welfare of the people of TNT. In the past, I've been able to make small contributions to the resolution of constitutional crises in Trinidad and Tobago. And today, I've been given the honor of speaking to this nation's current challenges and prospects. National independence implies coming of age, the capacity to make choices, and to act as a sovereign state among the community of nations. Independence also demands of a nation that it deals as effectively as it can with its challenges, institutionally, politically, economically, and socially. But no country at any moment has all the answers to the issues it faces. Measuring the success of independence, then, becomes a question of relative success. In celebrating this 52nd year of independence of TNT, we, and when I say we, I mean both those who live in Trinidad and Tobago, and those who hold a strong commitment to the welfare of the country, we should reflect on some questions about the growth and development of the nation. In this anniversary talk, I offer no clear answers to these questions, but only suggest that they are questions that should be considered at this point in the development of TNT as an independent, democratic, and republican state. A theme to note is the maturity, the independence, and the success of this nation, and also note that these achievements are still partial, and that, as in all nations, even the richest and the most powerful, there are many hard challenges to face. In his independence speech in 1962, the nation's first prime minister, Dr. Eric Williams, said that, and I quote, "The first responsibility that devolves upon you, the people of Trinidad and Tobago, is the protection and promotion of your democracy," unquote. He went on to say that, quote, "Democracy means responsibility of the government to its citizens and the protection of citizens from the exercise of arbitrary power," unquote. He also said that, quote, "Democracy means the subordination of the rights of any one race to the rights of the human race," unquote. Well, central to the democracy is the rule of law. The rule of law tells us that no one is above the law and that everyone is equal before and under the law. In democracies, government under the rule of law is extremely important. But the law must be just, because as St. Augustine wrote, an unjust law is no law at all. And when Dr. Williams said that the citizens of TNT should be protected from the exercise of arbitrary power, he meant that political power should not be exercised in an unrestrained way, with the aim simply of satisfying individual preference or convenience. Power must be exercised justly in accordance with law. All governmental action must accord with the rule of law and the Constitution. And if the country's constitution, that is to say, its most basic law, is to be changed, this requires a high degree of consent from those whose lives will be governed by it. In thinking about the state of Trinidad and Tobago's politics, its self-governing record, and its capacity, three questions seem appropriate for consideration. First, has the practice of democracy been strengthened in TNT? In thinking about this question, about our democratic experiment, we must ask the prior question of what is the conception of democracy in TNT? What is our model of democracy? What institutionally do we wish to build? What kind of parliamentary system, or indeed governmental system, will best serve us and meet our needs and objectives as a multiracial society? A society with two dominant ethnic groups or races. While there are three aspects to the issue of the state and democracy in TNT to question. The first aspect arises from current constitutional reform, the Constitution Amendment Bill 2014. Will it lead to greater or lesser participation by the people? As some of you may know, the changes include a two-term limit for the position of Prime Minister, recall of parliamentarians, and a runoff vote for elections in which no candidate gains 50% of the votes cast in a general election. However, more important than the examination of the merits of these proposals, and in fact amendments, is the basic democratic question of how democratic and how legitimate is the process for changing the country's constitution, basic law. What must we do to strengthen our democratic processes to ensure that we move closer to the ideals of a political regime that is based on the people's wishes and that has their consent? Should we seek to institute a national referendum for constitutional reform? Of course, as some of you would know, the bill has already been passed by the House of Representatives. And as I understand it, at about just after 11 o'clock last night, received approval in the Senate. It is noteworthy that a recent poll, the Maury Caribbean poll, on these amendments showed that a majority of those polled were in support of the reform package. 54% support the runoff elections. 70% support a right of recall of parliamentarians. And 55% support term limits for a prime minister. However, a commission poll is a far cry from a national referendum. And the question of whether there is democratic consent for such changes is unanswered. The second aspect of the strength of our democracy that arises from the operation of TNT TNT's upper house, the Senate. The Senate is an important part of our democracy. Currently, there are 11 cabinet ministers who are senators. 11. This means that 11 of the most powerful cabinet portfolios in the government of TT are filled by appointed rather than elected individuals. Equally significant, the Senate's basic purpose is neither administration nor holding government to account, but to give Parliament the capacity for second thought, for sober reflection of proposed legislation. But there has been virtually no debate on the practice of filling government with senator members. Is this, I ask you, in keeping with the constitutional conventions or constitutional practices in Westminster-style parliamentary democracies throughout the Commonwealth? I had the good opportunity to provide informal advice to the late President Robinson about appointing a large number of senators to the country's cabinet. More specifically, I advised him about the issue during the constitutional crisis of 2000-2001 over Senate appointments. One will find that typically only one senator is appointed to a cabinet in the Canadian experience. This is in keeping with British conceptions of parliamentary democracy, where the elected members of the House of Commons provide most of the cabinet members. The third aspect of democratic practice is the reluctance on the part of the public or public officials in TNT to embrace the Caribbean Court of Justice as the nation's final court of appeal. This reluctance suggests that some, if not all, of our politicians are concerned about the independence and impartiality of the Caribbean Court. This reservation will sooner or later need to be overcome. Ending appeals to the JCPC, the Judicial Committee of the Privy Council in England, could very well be a positive step in maturing as a nation, in realizing who we are and what we are capable of as a people in fully governing ourselves and in trusting our Caribbean neighbors. The second question for consideration this morning is as follows. Has Trinidad and Tobago been successful in balancing independence with interdependence? No country exists in a vacuum. And so in meeting our needs, have we been able to grow and develop with confidence and maturity in the last 52 years in the context of globalization? Have we developed mutually supporting relations with other nations? And have we assumed our share in meeting world responsibilities? Have we devised structures to protect and preserve our sovereignty and relative strength as a nation? While it's necessary to have trading partners, we are dependent on the US for the bulk of our exports, for example. We must have some sense that in the crunch, we can manage and protect to the best of our ability a satisfactory degree of economic and political independence. To achieve these goals, we must have a relatively strong sense of who we are as a people and as a nation. If we don't, then we must continue to search for what Robertson Davies has referred to as a nation's national soul. And that national soul needs to be based on more than tolerance, on understanding each other's situation and each other's aspirations. The third and final question for consideration relates to the country's public policy process. Of course, in comparative terms, we can ask questions about specific public policies and programs. Can we, for example, say with confidence that we have made significant progress or improvements in specific policy areas such as crime, health, employment, housing, education, inflation, construction of roads, and traffic management, and so on? If we have, that's great, as we move forward as a nation. If we haven't made significant progress, why? It is also noteworthy that the public opinion poll I mentioned earlier identified the issues I have mentioned as being among the most important facing the country. These are the statistics. 86% of those polled identified crime/police as the most important issue. 68% identified hospitals/health. 64% identified corruption in government. 47% ranked jobs/employment as one of the most important issues. And 32% ranked poverty/inequality. Whatever the limitations of these numbers, or the representativeness of the target individuals and or groups polled, the point is that these issues are on the minds of the people of TNT, and that is significant. It represents perhaps TNT's greatest challenge in emerging as a good state, a successful state, one which holds the confidence of the people who comprise it, of the people whom we all know yearn to respect and trust. When we reflect on the evolution of democracy itself, history teaches us that holding the course of political ideals is unfathomably difficult. But those who understand those ideals, those who publicly affirm those ideals, and who subscribe to the values that shape those ideals, and who do their utmost to consistently adhere to them, especially when it is not to their own advantage to do so, are the great prophets of our age, especially when they must row against the tide of opinion. We are able to learn a lot from those whose courage has made a difference in the world. For example, Mahatma Gandhi, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and yes, Nelson Mandela. Gandhi said that we have to be the change that we wish to see in the world. Dr. King observed that not everyone can be famous, but everybody can be great because greatness is determined by service. And Mandela, whose state funeral I had the good fortune of attending in South Africa, by the way, taught us that working together positively is far better for the future of a country than is any attempt to revenge past wrongs. Some will say that the challenges confronting the people of TNT make it difficult to relate such ideals in the concrete reality of the nation. But I say that when we look at these in historical, in practical, in global terms, TNT has been a comparative success as a relatively new democracy. If you agree, that very fact must provide some hope for a peaceful, progressive, and stable future for this Republican state. We may be deeply concerned over the problems that beset TNT, particularly in the areas of crime and governance, but as conscious and conscientious citizens or former citizens of TNT, we are here today because we care about its future. We care about policies and programs that would foster a safer, vibrant, and more democratic community, a place where we and our children and families and friends all can visit and live without concern for our health, safety, and well-being. A place where citizens can build careers and retire without the burden of worrying about safety, political stability, and well-being. A place that is multiracial and harmonious. I know that many of those who are here today see a role for themselves in contributing to a better and more prosperous democracy and society. You are here. We are directly and indirectly the makers of modern Trinidad and Tobago. TNT has wealth, yes. Oil, petroleum products, and other resources. But as Mandela wrote in his autobiography, Long Walk to Freedom, a nation's greatest wealth will always be its people. And so in moving forward as a nation, we, the people living in TNT and the diaspora, can make our contributions to a better nation. Our commitment to Trinidad and Tobago is grounded in Robert Kennedy's words, quote, "Our future may lie beyond our vision, but it is not beyond our control," unquote. Thank you very much for your time and attention.
Give me some volume. DNG with Philip!
Come on, spend a moment with me. Let me tell you about my country. CNC, sing it, CNC. We free from colonialism. Look how far we come from. CNC, tell them CNC. People, 1962, we get independent. The late Dr. Eric Williams signed a treaty with England. 52 years of independence. Over one nation, 52 years. The anti we free. 52 years anniversary.
52 years.
Hold our Trinity, 52 years. We celebrate it. Trinbago, we celebrate it.
Ah. Together we aspire. Together we achieve. Everyone have a right. Hey! TNT! Oh, joy it is. You can walk on the street, party on the street.
As a democratic country, cosmopolitan, and that is we. TNT, tell them.
TNT.
Freedom from martial cause, so we could embrace all people. TNT, sing it, TNT. As we journey on together, no one in the future. Greetings from Canada, with a token of honor. 52 years of independence. For our nation, 52 years. TNT, we free. 52 years anniversary. Hold our trilogy, 52 years, we celebrating. Trinbago, we celebrating.
No one can stand up because you're the head and out. So let's stand up, stand up, stand up. You're nursing good for you. And show them that you're proud. All you want in your voices, right? Sing the verse with me.
When we come in your blood, when we, they will miss you in the first four we sent.
TNT.
Tell them.
TNT.
Giselle Lawrence, she won this world. In the crop of the will he go sent.
TNT.
Tell them.
TNT.
Fire Lara, I go white your. I to hold on and let this talk. Oh God, let me know there is talent in Trinbago. 52 years of independence.
52 years.
Oh, our nation, 52 years. TNT, we free. Yes, we free.
52 years
anniversary.
52 years.
Hold our Trinity, 52 years. We celebrating. Trinbago, we celebrating.
Well, let me see your hands like this now. Show them. Show them. Yes, because you have to sing happy birthday for Trinidad and Tobago, eh?
You're
yes, sing your proud. I want to hear the voice of it. And remember, we have Darren Ganga coming up. So we're proud. Sing this with me.
Happy birthday to you.
All you sing it in with me.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy anniversary.
Happy birthday to you.
52 years now.
52 years of independence.
52 years.
For our nation, 52 years. TNT, we free. Yes, we free.
52 years.
Anniversary.
52 years.
Holy Trinity, 52 years. We celebrate.
Let's celebrate.
Trinbago, we celebrate.
Happy 52nd anniversary, everyone.